Hello, everybody, and welcome to Money Shift in the Morning. I am Thanasi, your host. And today, we got a little bit of a different... We got a different program for you guys today. Today, you'll notice right below me is Goodwood, which is a festival of speed that happens every year over in England. Effectively, what it is there is a house on top of a hill with a long driveway. It started off as a bit of a race, if you will, in terms of like how like race to the top, and then it just evolved into this crazy thing where not only manufacturers come out and show off their new toys, their new things, their new cars, but also classic cars like this Benetton can compete for overall fastest time up the hill, and you sort of get an appreciation for the super modern and the not so modern. So whenever there's a really cool car like this Benetton, what we're going to do is we're going to unmute and we're going to let it ride so that we can hear it if it sounds really great. But this guy's not giving it the beans at all. You hate to see that. Pretty awesome.
But this Maurice Philippe designed car was competitive. Certainly.
While this is playing, I'm going to hit that share button and then we will get going. Off, and
Ian Simmons is being uber cautious, for which you can understand. It's his first go up the hill in at least 2 years. So exploring where the grip might be and just reminding himself.
Still sound crazy, even though this guy's giving it like 40%.
Anthony Reid. Staff frequently here
crazy,
at,
even though this guy's
Goodwood
giving it like 40%.
The Escort Cosworth, watch him around Morecambe.
So Anthony Reid in a rally car. This is Nick Jarvis's ex-car.
Oh, God, I love the Ford Escort. This is one of my favorite body styles.
Next to go. And Ben Collins, I think, is going to be next with the Mercedes. But Anthony Reid in the Ford Escort, we're being told. To slot into that, it wouldn't be the Goodwood Festival of Speed without Anthony in something. And
all right,
here's the Sauber.
Kenny Atchison owns that car that he used to race in period with Mario Baldi and the Northern Irish driver. It's great to have him here.
All right. So I'm going to pause this and let's get into today's car news. And again, if you guys see any car that you like as you're watching this, like if you're like, T, I want to hear that, I want to see that, we'll move it here and we'll full screen it and we'll get it so that we can all watch and hear it. Well, this is the Sauber C9. It's one of my favorite race cars of all time. What a beautiful thing. Oh boy. All right. I'm getting distracted myself, but we got some news ahead of us, so let's get into it. Let's talk about it. It's still fun stuff. Hey, it might not be as in-depth as yesterday. Oh, spoiler alert. One of the cars that we're going to be talking about later on is actually this one. So maybe it's worth it to just do one of these. Check this thing out. The Ford Puma Hybrid Rally 1. We'll get into this car's details later on. But for those of you that are watching, we get to see it up the hill.
Next year's rally car than the Goodwood Festival of Speed. And Formo treating this like a
cruiser.
He's really pressing on and having to adapt.
Love that.
Like
love when people go all out on the hill.
A look at it first. After the Puma, there is the Tatius of Jamie Chadwick. This is the car.
Zoom.
In the
57.7's pretty good. Pretty good. All right, so we're going to close that off. Move that there. Do this. All right, here we go. So the first vehicle that we're going to be looking at today is the BMW CE04 electric scooter. And again, for those of you just tuning in, below me is the Goodwood Festival of Speed. This is the live stream happening right now. After we finish today's car news, we're going to keep the stream on and we're just going to talk about, you know, and just hang out about the cars that we're going over. Like, look at this, the Mach-E that Von Gittin built, 1,700 horsepower thing. So we'll get through today's news and then we'll blow up the Goodwood stream and we'll check it out and watch it together. So the first vehicle that we're going to be talking about is this BMW CE04 electric scooter. With an 8.9 kilowatt hour battery, this thing has 80 miles of range, which is actually really, really great. Shout out to Who Is Fat Matt with the like. Welcome, my man. Welcome, welcome. What up, man? What up to you as well, dude. This thing has 80 miles of range, air cooling to regulate the temperature. I think we should just talk about and watch this Subaru really quick. You guys might remember this car from the recent Gymkhana video. Running up the hill right now. Going to be far adrift, I wouldn't have thought, because this again has got a lot of commitment being put in. Look at him, he's sending it. I love when people send it up the Goodwood Hill. 51-1. Not hands of bad. Not bad at all. Okay, all right, all right. Oh, look at this. Guys, this is tough. This is tough, but we're going to push through. We're going to push through the car news so we can watch this stream together, because this is really, really fun. I'm going to be honest. But let's finish the news. There's not as much to talk about as there was yesterday, but the sooner we finish, the sooner we can watch Goodwood together and hang out. So this BMW CE04 electric scooter, again, 8.9 kilowatt hour battery with 80 miles of range. This thing leverages air cooling in order to regulate the temperature in the scooter. This thing does actually have level 2 charging capability. So this thing can charge at 6.9 kilowatt, which means that it can go 0 to 100% in just an hour and 40 minutes, which is pretty spectacular if you think about most scenarios, right? Who is Fat Matt? I'll show you some Goodwood, you know what I mean? Oh my God. Oh boy. That's funny. So continuing on here, 45 minutes gets you a charge from 20% to 80%, and an hour 40 gets you a charge from dead to full. You can coast, you can one-pedal drive in this thing, and this has a host of features that are available on BMW motorcycles that make this scooter a bit special. This thing has ABS standard, but it also has ABS Pro available, which adds an auto brake when you're leaning into corners. This thing has BMW's ASC slip control, which is their automatic stability control. It also has dynamic traction control available, which also takes into account how much the scooter's leaning in terms of how to put on that power. This thing also has a 10.25 inch HD display, which includes things like navigation and smartphone connectivity. And there's a premium package you can get, which gives you an LED adaptive headlight as well, and a heated seat. The price that you're looking at, though, for this thing is $11,795. So it's definitely not cheap, but it comes to play in terms of the features it offers in order to, you know, like, be worthy of that price. I think it is. It's one of the first electric scooters as well. So before we move on to the next two vehicles, let's watch a couple runs up the hill. The next two vehicles that we're going to be looking at are, in fact, vehicles that debuted at Goodwood. So who knows? We might just see the other one. Yes, indeed. So for those of you that aren't too familiar with Goodwood, I can give you guys a bit of a history lesson. But this car that we're looking at on screen right now, this is the Glickenhaus Hypercar Fighter. So this is the Glickenhaus, the SCG, the vehicle that will be competing for the overall win at Le Mans. This is the SCG 007. Shout out to Cameron Glickenhaus, by the way, for finishing cars and getting them up this hill. Pretty, pretty awesome. This thing is a sick thing. And they've also produced a couple street-driven ones. If you check out their Instagram, it's pretty great. We'll get quicker as the weekend goes on, that's for sure. Roman knows his way around here, but I think I was saying this on Radio Goodwood this morning, it's going to be a really evenly matched shootout. So for those that have never heard of this and are watching this for the first time, effectively what you're seeing is a race up someone's driveway. The Goodwood Festival of Speed is an annual hill climb event started in the early 90s. This takes place in West Sussex, England. The record holder, for those of you watching these times right now, the record holder for going up this hill is the Volkswagen IDR, with that guy actually, Romain Dumas, who was just driving the Glickenhaus car, in 39.9 seconds. So that's really, really fast, right? But that's, you know, the thing that you sort of need to keep in mind here. The goal was effectively Lord March, who was the owner of the Goodwood Estate, wanted to bring back motorsport to England. So he has a Goodwood circuit, which is actually a street, not a street circuit, but a traditional racetrack, But then they also wanted to do some things on their own ground, so that's where this came into play. It started as just, you know, a hill climb up his long driveway, and it evolved into the event that you see today, where brands are going for the overall win with their race cars, companies are showing off their classic cars, collectors are bringing in their cool, you know, Alfa Romeo Tipos like this thing, right? Cars that you would never see, and they're hauling ass with them. Look how fast James Wood is driving this thing. And it's got to be terrifying to drive, right?
And James not hanging about.
At the Goodwood Festival of Speed, though, it's not just this hill climb. There's actually a bunch of different things. So the first thing, though, the main thing, the Catalina wine mixer, the first thing is this hill climb. The second, they actually have a soapbox derby challenge for gravity-powered cars that start below the hill climb finish line and race all the way to the front of the house. There's also a rally stage on the backside. There's a supercar paddock, all that stuff. There's tons of things to check out at the Goodwood Festival of Speed. It's pretty awesome. Matt says, yo, random question I never thought of. Can these drivers do multiple runs over the span of the event, and can one driver run multiple cars throughout the event? Yes, Matt. That's actually very popular at the Goodwood Festival of Speed, is one car running, or one driver running more than one car over the weekend. That is a popular concept. Now, if you're like a Porsche driver, right, you're not going to be running a Ferrari. But if you're just, you know, a generalist, if you will, you can certainly run different types of cars and different things over the weekend. Popped a tire. There it goes. Oh, it didn't pop a tire. It popped it off. That's also one of the sad things, but also kind of nice things to see at Goodwood. I don't know. I'm curious how you guys feel about this. If someone crashes a car here, a priceless car, and it's happened often, right? There's been RS200s that have found the wall. There's been some prototypes that have found the wall, all this stuff. I feel like it's a good way for the car to go out. Granted, you can often restore these cars. It is really, really sad. But, you know, something like this that we're looking at is a 1930s Le Mans car for Aston Martin. That thing's probably priceless, right? And this guy just, you know, binned the wheel off of it. Obviously not his own fault, but it happened, you know. All right, as this happens, I'm going to minimize this screen and we're going to get to a of car news. Ooh, look at this. Is this a cheetah? Yeah, it is. Cheetah. All right, so as they sort out what happened, oh, what you guys are going to be looking at. All right. Bang. What we're looking at with the next vehicle is actually a car that debuted at Goodwood, and that is a Polestar 2. But it's not just any Polestar 2. It seems to be quite a specific one, a model, a variant that we've never seen before. This Polestar 2 has, first off, it has the performance pack, so it has the Olin suspension, it has the Brembo brakes, it has the gold seat belts. These are all things, by the way, that you can get on a Polestar 2 today. You can buy a car with Olin's right from Polestar. But number two, what this one has is more power. A lot. This thing has 470 brake horsepower thanks to twin electric motors, which is up 70 from the standard car. But not only does it have, you know, more power, it's wider. A lot wider. Look at the stance of this thing. This front three-quarter shot is pretty cool. This thing looks incredible, right? Wider hips, wider splitter, wider wheel and tire. It also has more brakes. This thing has the 6-piston front brakes from the Polestar 1 on this car. So I have no idea what this is showing off. If this is showing off a special Polestar 2 that takes on the likes of a Model 3 performance, or is this showing off the underpinnings for what will be a Polestar 3 or a Polestar 4, right? It could go either way. This could either be a hot rod version of the Polestar 2, which would be awesome because this thing looks incredible, or it could be the underpinnings for a future vehicle. But this car debuted at Goodwood. It's going to be making a climb up the hill, probably made one today. But for those of you that are new to Goodwood, it goes on all weekend, but Sunday is the main shtick. What goes down Sunday is a timed run from the bottom to the top. So that's where the records come into play. And the really, really interesting thing about Goodwood on Sunday is you can sort of benchmarks sometimes. It's kind of like Nürburgring times, right? Because everything isn't equal. You know, Matt isn't driving every single car up the hill, so it's not standardized. But it's still fun to see what a Polestar 2 like this one that has, you know, almost 500 horsepower, all-wheel drive, whatever, whatever, what time that car can put in versus a car like this one, the Chevrolet Cheetah, right? Like, and this is the only place in the world you're going to get that opportunity. And Sunday is when you start to see people pushing really, really hard to get the fastest time. So if you guys are looking for something to tune into over the week, just throw on the Goodwood live stream like we got here. It's really good background chat, and it's a really, really fun event. We're supposed to head there this year, but ticket prices were crazy for flights to get out there, which is no bueno. Now, the last bit of news that we're going to be talking about, and then hopefully everything will be clear, is actually a car that you guys just saw run up the hill if you were an early, early adopter to the stream today. And that is the newest WRC car from Ford. This is the Ford Puma Hybrid, and this will take place, or this will take part in the 2022 WRC Championship. Now, for those of you that need a slight refresher, in 2022, WRC is changing, and I'd argue they're changing for the better. They're leveraging a 1.6-liter turbocharged engine and adding a 100-kilowatt electric motor that is mated to a 3.9-kilowatt-hour battery in order to give you a hybrid WRC car. Now, not only did they switch to hybrid WRC cars, but they also added the fact that you had to sort of opt in for the long term. This was not something that you could just take place in for 1 year and then sort of back off. And currently, the three brands that we have competing that are under contract to contest in the 2022 WRC Championship are Ford with this Puma, Hyundai with an unannounced vehicle, and Toyota with an unannounced vehicle. So three brands have committed to the WRC Championship for next year. Now, these 1.6-liter turbocharged engines and the electric motors combine to create for something that's proper quick. Like, these cars are definitely going to be fast. We've seen some videos of the Hyundai WRC car tackling just testing, and it looks to be pretty nutso, like pretty insane. And this one's no different. In fact, we saw this car go up the hill literally 20 minutes ago, and it stormed up it. It went very, 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 very quick. The rally cars will have to run on electricity when they're moving around the service park. So when they're driving from their tent to the beginning of the stage, they'll have to move under electric power. They will also be allowed to use hybrid stuff as a performance boost at various times during the stage. These are the very first plug-in hybrid race cars to run in a major championship, right? Because you either have cars like Formula E, which are dedicated electric vehicles, or you have cars like the LMH cars, which are dedicated hybrids. There's nothing quite like these WRC cars, which are plug-in hybrids. So pretty, pretty, pretty cool. The rules for next year are actually really exciting. I for one am super jazzed for this car. Let's see, do I have any more details on it? The Puma Rally 1 shares a platform with the Ford Fiesta. So this is a car that we do know, or that you guys all should know in the Ford Fiesta, right? Shouldn't be a foreign car to you guys. And the Puma itself actually used to be a rally car at various points during its life as well. So, you know, super cool. And let's be honest, guys. You know, you may not buy into it, but race cars do advance road car technology. It's the reason why Toyota's Le Mans hypercar class is R&D budget and not marketing budget. And it's the reason why Toyota's competing in this series, because they can take a plug-in hybrid to its limits, and they can take that reliability knowledge, they can take that performance knowledge, they can take the charging learnings that they figure out, and they can adapt it and put it in their road cars. So this is definitely huge, right? Top-level rallying is committing to also using a sustainable fossil-free fuel in competition next year as well. So not only are these going to be plug-in hybrid things, but they'll also be using synthetic-based fuels. So Rally overall is looking to sort of take the tech to the next level. So super, super excited. I think this Puma looks incredible in WRC, guys. For those of you that don't know what this looks like otherwise, I'll pull up a photo right now, but effectively it's a small SUV. Think about it as something we wish we could have gotten here in the States instead of the EcoSport, which we do have. This is a lot more stylish. It's effectively a Ford Fiesta-based SUV. Super nice. It looks really nice, and it comes in a sporty variant, et cetera, et cetera. People were pissed because the Ford Puma is usually a smaller hatchback, so to make it an SUV was kind of annoying. But if you look at the road car photo that I'm about to show you guys, you'll be like, well, that's pretty much a hatchback anyway, and you'd be right. Let me pull up that photo right now. Bum, ba, ba. God, I hate when you download something and it ends up being a like WebP file. You know what I mean? So you go through all the effort, you're like, yeah, this is a picture I'm gonna show off. This is gonna be great, everyone's gonna love it. And then bang, it's just fail blog because it's a WebP file. Like, come on, what are we doing here? You know what I mean? Like, what, how's a WebP file okay with anybody? Like, does anybody use that? I don't know. I mean, I guess you do if you're making web pages, you know what I mean? But not I. Okay. Here we go. So this is the road car variant of that rally car. This is the Ford Puma ST. So you guys can see, right? Nothing crazy here. This is a small SUV, and it's SUV only because it's like slightly higher off the ground. This kind of reminds me of like the last generation GLA, where like it was, you know, a drop away from pretty much just being a hatchback. And this is the same. So it makes sense for the brand to use it as their sort of WRC car. They're promoting an SUV, and they get to compete in a sort of plug-in hypercar style series for off-road, which is super exciting. I don't know if you guys are as excited about that as I am, but with all the car news out of the way, actually, let me do a quick reset so I can give you guys all the information, and then we will flick on Goodwood for, you know, maybe another 20 minutes or so. We'll hang out and watch some live stream of Goodwood together. The first bit of news is BMW released their all-electric scooter. This is the BMW CE04. This has an 8.9 kilowatt hour battery with 80 miles of range. This thing also has regenerative braking. It charges from 0 to 100% in an hour and 40 minutes, or just 45 minutes to do 20 to 80%. This thing has ABS. This thing has a pro version of ABS, which takes into account leaning. It has stability control. It has dynamic traction control. It has Apple CarPlay, Android Auto. It has navigation. It has an LED adaptive headlight with a heated seat. This thing comes to play, but you pay for it as well. It's $11,000. But this is one of the first electric scooters, and you see some pretty neat storage options in this BMW. Places for helmets, places for more sort of like trunk space. This thing's got immense amounts of storage compartments, which is really cool. Second vehicle that we're talking about today is another vehicle that made its debut at Goodwood, and it's an interesting version of the Polestar 2. This is unlike any Polestar 2 we haven't seen. The only thing that this has currently in parity with its road-going partner is the performance pack. This thing has the Ohlins dampers. This thing has the gold brakes. This thing has the gold seat belts, just like you can get on an existing Polestar 2. Where this car differs from the existing Polestar 2 is it is wider. This car has an overall wider track, which means wider wheels, wider flares, different splitters, etc., etc. This thing also has about 80 horsepower more than its road-going brother. This thing makes nearly 500 horsepower. Now, is this going against a Tesla Model 3, or is this going against something else, or is this just the underpinnings for a new Polestar vehicle? We are not entirely sure, but I'm excited to see this go up and down the hill. And then the last vehicle we talked about is the Ford Puma WRC. This is the car that Ford will be doing battle with in 2022 for the WRC series. And that, again, for those of you that don't remember, the rules are changing. They're switching to a 1.6-liter turbocharged plug-in hybrid race car. These things have to operate under electric power in the paddock and then go nutso crazy fast on the strip, and Ford is switching from using the Fiesta to using the Puma. So pretty interesting stuff there coming in 2022. But with that out of the way, we can get back to the main event. For those of you that just tuned in, Goodwood is going on all week, and it started today or yesterday. And we got some pretty interesting things coming by way of Goodwood. Actually, I think I'm going to show you guys one of the most interesting hills already. Someone tagged me in this. I believe it was Dan. Shout out to Dan Mack. But he tagged me in the Apollo Intensa Emozione going up and down the hill, which was pretty insane to see. Yeah, here we go. All right, let me share this screen as well so you guys can watch this. But this is the beauty, right? You get to see cars you never would see going crazy. Oh, that's not what I wanted. Yeah, you get to see cars that you would never see go up a hill, cars that you would never see, you know, race, things that you're used to seeing at like a Cars and Coffee or a Concours event, and you get to see them go nuts. This is the Apollo Intensa Emozione. Let's hear it. Well, we got to hear that again because I had you guys muted. So for those of you that don't know, this is a naturally aspirated biggin of an engine. It's a large boy. Look at that thing. Gorgeous. You got to play the fine balance, right? Like, you want to show people the performance capabilities, but in the same time, you don't want to bin a car that's millions of dollars. What a beautiful color this thing is. A lot of times they do burnouts in this area. Let's see it. Jesus Christ. And the Regera catches up to it at the end because this guy doesn't know what he's doing. Bonkers. Okay, let's get back to the action. There we go. What happened to Goodwood? There it is. Hell yeah, brother. We got NASCARs going up the hill. We got everything going up the hill. Ooh, yeah, look at this thing. Gorgeous. Yeah, so the controversy around this Alfa Romeo specifically is when it ran in the Touring Car Championship. When this car ran in the Touring Car Championship, there were rules at the time that you couldn't run any crazy aero that wasn't available on the road car. So what Alfa Romeo did was for every 155 they sold, they included a specific aero piece, but they gave it to you in the trunk. They were like, hey, there's a specific wing if you want to use it, whatever. But because they included it in the sale of the car, they could use it on their race car. And with that, they had more aerodynamics, more downforce than anybody else, and they won handily. Pretty funny story there. Julian Thomas has a very nice beautiful 3 Series touring car. Love the E36 touring car. They look awesome. Ooh, a Ford Sierra Cosworth. This is the RS500 that you would actually see compete in the British touring car. So contrary to popular belief, the Sierra Cosworth was not only a WRC car, but it was also a damn good touring car. This car won almost as many, I would actually venture it was a more successful touring car than it was a rally car. For sure. This thing kicked all the ass in BTCC. And we got a V8 supercar here. Rick Wood piloting the Commodore. We know this car as the Pontiac G8 here in the States. Faster time than that NASCAR. 59.48. I'm going to remember that time. Let's see how that compares. This is an SK120. Look at this thing, right? So in what place would you see a V8 supercar climb up a hill followed by a Jaguar MK2? Right? Nowhere. And yeah, he's struggling. This guy's trying to figure out, you know, where the gas is, where the brake is, where the clutch is, how to just operate life, you know what I mean? But you still get to hear, see it. He's doing his best. The British salute car races of a decade or so before, so in a minute, it's gone past, as I know, but the Patrick Modell Group, 1275... Look at that little mini! So that's the other thing, is they release cars in a regular cadence. So if the guy going behind is hauling all the ass like this mini was, he'll catch the car in front. Look at that beautiful mini. And famously won the all-mini race. Massive kudos. And it's an Austin one as well. Ooh. Here we have a Nissan GTR from the classic series. This is an OG race car from HKS. Sick. This car went faster than the V8 supercar. 53, went faster by 6 seconds. Matt says, it's wild that cars are just starting to look like GTA cars now. Yeah, no kidding, Matt, right? That's definitely true. Ugh, this car holds a special place in my heart. This is my favorite touring car of all time. This is the Renault Laguna that was driven by Alan Menu. These cars were unstoppable. And look at how good this looks. I will fight anybody if they say that there is a better looking touring car than this thing. Shout out to Joe Scott. What up, my man? This is one of the best looking sedan-based race cars, if not the best sedan-based race car of all time. This thing is gorgeous, and it flat out dominated. This car was unstoppable. Look at that thing. It's so beautiful. I didn't pour the Renault Laguna today. I'm going to be honest with you guys. What up, Joe? Good morning, my man. We're just watching some Goodwood today. We went over some car news. You know, a couple things. Nothing crazy. Three pieces of news. Electric scooters. Stuff like that. But we're just hanging out now. We're watching Goodwood, talking about the cars. If I can provide any added story to some of these things. Right here is a Rover. This SD1 also competed in touring car racing. This was an interesting design because all the other cars were either more conventional sedans, and this thing was really kind of a hatch. And it didn't have as much aero as the other cars, but it did its thing. There is going to be Rob Bell with the McLaren, which is another car that could be a dark horse for winning the shootout. Look at this. Ford Fiesta Pikes Peak car. Now, people bring these cars here with the intention of winning the shootout on Sunday. And again, if you're just tuning in, these cars go up the hill right now. These are all practice sessions, really. Sunday, they have a timed session where they're going for the fastest time. And you see cars like this compete against cars like this. This is the McLaren 720S GT3X. As a reminder for you guys, this is if a GT3 car was unregulated. So it's interesting to see. Look at that time. 48.91. That is quick. That was 10 seconds faster than the V8 supercar. Ooh, this is interesting. This is a car that no one thought existed, but it actually does. This is the Scuderia Cameron Glickenhaus road car. This is the road-going version of the car that is taking on the hypercar class. This is a center seat vehicle. You sit in the middle, two seats to your left and right. Again, this is a Scuderia Cameron Glickenhaus. Shout out to SCG for making their cars and making them badass. This thing is a really good-looking thing, and it has a center seat configuration. configuration, just like a McLaren F1. You can see the driver right there, sitting in the center. Joe says, I was going to say Goodwin in the morning. Wow, yeah, Goodwin in the morning is always a great start, my man. I agree. And that's what we're doing. See, like, look at that. There it is. It's the SCG, and it's running. Contrary to popular belief, I don't know if John Raftery is in the chat, but John is not a Goodwood, or excuse me, an SCG fan. I love it. Good looking car.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens in second and third practice, because there are cars that tend to find full seconds, you know, 2-3 seconds. And actually,
look at this. So this is after the hill climb. This is what you take to get back down.
Might be quite close to what he can manage.
So while Joe, you find a Miata yet? Joe, I've actually sent. So there's an NC Miata locally that I'm going to check out. Oh, here are the times really quick. So we got that McLaren that we just watched, top of the timesheets. That Jaguar is a Le Mans car that competed way back when. Third place is the Hoonigan. This is the car that did the viral video. That is third place. Fourth place, a 992 GT3 Cup car. Pretty cool. And then rounding off the top five is a Le Mans car. New Puma hybrid. So Joe says, you find a Miata yet? There's an NC Miata locally. NASCAR, I'm going to turn this down. There's an NC Miata locally that they want me to go check out. I don't know how I feel about it. I made a similar offer on a Power Hardtop NC Miata that's actually in Florida that a MoneyShift viewer found. Shout out to John Lawson. So going to see what they say about that machine. Half of me also wants to import something from the UK, like a Renault Laguna that we just saw, like maybe a Vauxhall Cavalier or something like that. So I don't know. I'm in no rush. Also including the Boxster in that sort of list of cars that I'm considering, but yeah, I'm in no rush right now, which is good, 'cause it means that I can sort of just like hang out and wait and find the right car. You know what I mean? Look at this guy. If this guy doesn't say Goodwood, I don't know what does.
50.04 seconds, but that's history, because we've got a new fastest car, fastest driver, and it's the very
there it is. This is the 720
GT3X.
48.91 is fast. It's about 10 seconds off the world record, but you got to remember the record is a Volkswagen IDR.
First place, but I'll let you in a secret. That's the first time I've been up the hill in anger, so. That's a big, big shock, and I think we'll be pushing on, but so far so good. We're really happy with that.
There seems to be about five cars within 5 seconds, which might seem a lot on a circuit, but here people are just dialing themselves in, yourself included. But I guess there's always that question when you get back down, just where, which corner, you know, what did I not get right? It's you do analyze.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I said, it's the first time I've done the timed run, so I'm not really sure how it's going to work.
Yeah, that's a good thing, right? Because you have drivers like this guy who've driven Goodwood plenty of times, but they've never done it for time. They've just driven up the hill. So when he says things like, this is the first time I've driven in anger, what he means is like, this is the first time I've pursued a top time at Goodwood.
It's McLaren Plus, isn't it? The very, very best. Rob, enjoy. Keep going.
Enjoy. Keep going. Thanks, dude. Yep. Appreciate that. Thanks for the feedback. Good looking machine. You can see the other cars that just ran up at the hill there. This is another shot of Goodwood. This is the estate.
And fascinating that he has actually
a lot of brands, car manufacturers, stuff like that have sort of a post here. So like you can see, you know, like it's kind of like a car show. You can see all the new Toyotas, the new Lotuses, whatever. I'm sure there's a Lotus Emira there as well. There's also an auto auction that takes place, a Bonham auction. Some pretty nice cars here. 575M Super America. Hell yeah. Wow, a 20s Maserati. Yikes. All I see is dollar signs. Ooh, this is the one right here. Look at that thing. Beautiful, beautiful race car. AC Ace Roadster. Contrary to popular belief, AC did not just make cars for Shelby Cobras. Ferrari F40, hell yeah. Wow, look at this thing. It's a coach-built Zagato Continental GT. Joe says, this is where I first saw the Aston Martin Zagato shooting brake. Probably one of the best wagons I've ever seen, and probably the best one you will ever see. Joe, I will say, I have it on good authority that there are plenty of folks locally. There's actually one guy locally that daily drives an Aston Martin Zagato. So it's not the end of the world to say that you won't see another one again. Gotta love an ad that says we're going to bring battery building to the United Kingdom to supply our country with jobs and blah, blah, blah. Love it. I'm all for some good, you know, propaganda. You know what I mean? What do we got here? This is the Goodwood. Are they getting ready for the circuit? Oh, is there a horse racing circuit here too? I didn't know that. I did not know that, actually, that they had a horse racing circuit either attached or near the same area. It's just such an amazing place, man. Like I said, I was supposed to get out there this year with my brother. We bought tickets to go last year, but it was obviously canceled. It was postponed, then it was canceled. And we were going to go this year, but ticket prices to get there, to get to the UK, were well over $1,500. And we're talking about just to get there. Never mind hotel, never mind rent a car, never mind anything like that. So, a bit crazy. There's a lot of demand to just get to the Goodwood area this year. Not that that's the only reason people are going to the UK at this time of year, but it was definitely one of the major ones. We'll get there. We'll get there for sure. Definitely a classic event. Has anybody in chat gone to Goodwood? Joe, when you're saying where you first saw the shooting break, do you mean in person? Or did you see it on like a live stream and you were like, holy shit? Because that's pretty awesome. I mean, either way, it's awesome, right? I'm not going to sit here and say otherwise, but... Believer. Believer. No, I've never been, but I saw it on live stream. Okay. I mean, hey, it would have been cracked if you went. I would have been sick, but either way, yeah, kudos to you for doing what some don't, which is even know that the live stream exists. Guys, this is the best thing to just, like, tune into, you know? Look how happy this guy is. Oh, look at this. We're going Renault Laguna in the background. But people forget that when you sit this is the mini driver. Nice. Single seater
car, you almost go over a brow, and the saying is, if you can see Malcolm, you're braking too late. Did no one tell you that?
Which one's Malcolm?
Look at this. What a beautiful machine. Shout out to Matt Jennison from Misfits if he's in the chat.
His brake's stuck on, so I
what a cool thing, man. So awesome to see OG minis going full tilt.
Fantastic. And it's also just looking around behind you, the diversity of machinery. It's astonishing.
Oh, it's ridiculous. You know, you do just walk around in this constant, like, wow, rabbits in the headlights type thing, you know.
It's true.
It's such a spectacle.
It's just an impressive event.
Best of luck. Maximize your time.
It is still remarkable.
Look at this, dude. You got tables. You can sit, hang out, be right next to the strip where you can watch, you know, some not-so-mental machines just going up and down the track. Guys, we got another about 10 minutes watching the Goodwood Festival before we call it. We'll probably do a similar thing again tomorrow, if I'm going to be honest. I don't know how much car news we're going to have, but we'll also watch the live stream just like today. So now you can see the cars that ran up the hill coming down. So right up front, that was the Ford Puma Hybrid. This is a Praga right here, I believe. Yeah, Praga, beautiful car. That's a car that is the Formula One series for women, the FIAW. Here's the Ford Puma Hybrid that we just talked about, the EcoSport Hybrid. That was car news today, actually. I think this is a March Formula One car, if I remember correctly. And then right behind it is the Scuderia Cameron Glickenhaus that has taken part in the Le Mans Hypercar Series, that red white car right there. It's a Tyrell in the front or a Benetton. There's a Sauber. Here's the Praga again. It's the FIAW car. Here's the Puma.
Must be a very frustrating car to race all the time, especially in a kind of...
Joe says, I'm heading out to PA in a few weeks, and I'm going to check out the Simeon. Simeon? Oh, yeah, dude. Beautiful museum. That'd be awesome. You definitely have to report back. That's one of those things where I've seen and heard people talk about it, but I've never been myself. It's definitely supposed to be one of the better ones out there in the States. So, yeah, let me know. Let me know how that is for sure. for sure.
And on a wet day, it can happen. If you remember back in the 90s, the British Touring Car Championship had the old ICS Historic Touring Car Championship.
Yeah, look at this. You have a HKS R32. Right behind it, you have a NASCAR. Right behind it, you have a V8 supercar. Like, where else in the world are you going to have an experience like that, where you can have a Mustang Mach-E with 1,700 horsepower, the Hoonigan Porsche, I mean a Subaru, an F1 car, a brand new Porsche GT3 club car, BTCC Sierra Cosworth Formula One cars, this thing, whatever the hell this is.
And interestingly, I suppose that car is partly to thank for his son Damon's racing career, because the Hill family.
Shout out to the Cheetah, those things are cool.
Damon's racing to get him to Formula One, which ended up, of course, with the Formula One World Championship to become the very rare father and son duo that both won the World Championship.
And Damon is here this weekend.
E36 touring car right there, beautiful thing as well. One of the better cars in touring car form, I feel, the E36. Not that they don't look good normally, but when they're in touring car guys, they look terrific. Oh, and then there it is. Look at that Laguna, guys. Come on, the green one. Incredible thing. Got a boogie of a solid day, man. You too, Joe. Thanks for stopping in. And if you guys haven't already, don't forget to hit that like button like Joe did. And if you're enjoying the stream, don't forget to hit that follow button as well, so you guys can be in the know. And just, you know, hang out. How many car places you got going on? You know what I mean? We're here. We're hanging out. We're watching Goodwood together, talking about the cars that we're seeing on the screen. So if you guys want to watch the Goodwood live stream, just watch it here. We're hanging out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. And you know, Sally's here every year. And she always, you know, gets stuck in, puts it in the time section. And actually, the 1914 Mercedes Grand Prix that George Wingard's in, he has only ever missed two Festival of Speed, which is fantastic. And you see the likes of Travis, you know, hasn't been up the hill before.
Travis Pastrana, first time up the hill with the in one of the fastest cars, I'm assuming, at the hill. So it'll be interesting to see what that Subaru will be able to do when it comes to that time trial session on Sunday. Car's definitely capable of getting that fast top time, so it'll be interesting to see if Travis will be able to sort of wrap his head around the course in that time.
So some of those cars making their way to the paddock. Let's have another look at some of those best bits from that last batch with the...
Oh, they're doing a little highlight reel from that last batch, so let's take a watch.
Who was first away. Anthony Reid in this Ford Escort, I find it intriguing.
Oh, beautiful.
Anthony in a rally car. But he's just
beautiful Praga.
So then you had the Praga with Ben Collins at the wheel of it, the Stig of years past. Caitlin Wood, as we've now discovered,
there it is,
driving the
Hoonigan.
W Series. There's Julian Thomas in that Sierra, and Travis Pastrana, I think he's going to be
Mach-E.
A
that thing's probably going to be mental up the hill as well.
Adrian Formo, the Expied de Toisy Spice in the hands of Jeremy Smith. And Justin Law in the Jaguar, another potential winner of the
shootout. That M1 Pro car going out.
Exelio D'Angelo,
going crazy.
M1 from the Pro Car Series. Marina McLaughlin's Derek Warwick Arrows A10.
I love seeing people going all out, man. Because we weren't around, right? Like, we weren't around in this period. So to see these cars going as fast as they're going.
The wheel at least having the good grace to bounce off the
pretty awesome.
Was okay. The car
and it also puts in perspective, right? Like, you'll have some of these modern race car drivers driving these old cars like this Cheetah, like this, right? And the first thing they say when they get out of it is, holy shit, that thing's hard to drive. And like, they give props to those that used to drive it. You know what I mean? Like, because it's pretty crazy.
With the Mercedes. Illustrating the commitment put in from the driver and just how narrow those tires are. Total contrast from NASCAR or the Super Touring Alfa Romeo 155. Big smiles on the face of the drivers. A sideways.
Everyone's having fun. Look at that.
It got slower as it went up the hill. Mark Jones was being pretty circumspect in the XLR menu. Jason Plato, Renault Laguna, and with four-wheel drive at the wheel of Godzilla, Jake Hill was pressing on. Car owner Rick Wood taking to the hill in his Holden Commodore. But at the end of it, it was Rob Bell who would be the fastest. And despite having never been up the hill in what he calls anger before, he topped the times. So more to come from the competition cars very shortly, because we will have the
nice
Festival of Speed highlights and the FIA batch coming up shortly.
Yes. We'll tune in. We'll stick around for this FIA batch because this is going to be a good one, and then we'll call it a day after this segment. But we got awesome, awesome cars coming soon, including an SUV? Question mark. Jaguar's been doing this thing recently at Goodwood's where they just get cars up on two wheels for the whole ride up. So I wonder if that's the same thing for this.
This is his practice to see whether he can do the whole hill.
I think he's done that in previous years.
Yes.
One wonders if he's that set on going up there on two wheels, whether or not he just tries a motorbike at some point.
That's a very funny statement. This guy goes, if he's obsessed with going up the hill on two wheels,
it's incredible to watch.
I wonder if he'll just use a motorbike at some point.
Waka waka waka. Love it.
I have a vague recollection that one year he got up to heading towards Flint Wall and it just teetered towards the bales.
Ooh, a bread van. A bread van. This is good. This is good. Guys, I'm having a ton of fun here. This is great watching the Goodwood Festival of Speed with everybody. Thank you for tuning in this morning. If you guys like the content that you're watching, don't forget to hit that like button, the share, subscribe, whatever you got to do so that we can hang out and watch some stuff together. You know, I see gaming streams. I see esports streams. I see all that, but I don't see anybody watching Goodwood. But you got Money Shift here watching Goodwood with you guys. Good morning. Hope everyone is doing well on this fine Thursday. We had some crazy lightning yesterday around here, so these cars should be ready to go shortly, and then we should be on our way for our next session. This has been coined as the FIA session. Not entirely sure what that means, but I'm assuming it just means, you know, a bunch of cars that are two race spec and not this sort of, you know, interesting innovative thing. I don't know, we'll see.
Terry Grant doing it in a car or Gilbert Batailles on it doing it in a truck is the more difficult.
It is quite a niche talent, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. There's not much call for it, really.
No,
the week.
Odd. But, yeah. Odd.
They're still talking about the guy that wants to take a Jaguar up on two wheels.
He must have run from his cheetah and is now in the Beast of Turin.
There you go, Matt. So, Matt, if you're still tuning in, they just mentioned a guy that ran from the cheetah that just went up on the hill to another vehicle. So, it definitely does happen at the Goodwood Festival of Speed.
But it also must blow your mind as you're sat at some traffic lights.
Yeah,
and that thing pulls off. Because it's what
it'll all go dark. Let's start, won't it?
Because what you don't
look at
see
this, you know, people, everyone dresses up, they're feeling good, sitting down, having some wine. Just enjoying the sights, sounds, car racing, right? There's not much better that you could do on a Thursday than kick back with a glass of wine, listening and watching some amazing cars go up and down. Look at these two vehicles right there. You got a NSU or a right in front, and then you got a Camaro right behind it, and then a pair of Corolla touring cars right behind that, one of which is a hybrid.
Like, you can imagine Duncan sort of leaning out.
Can't get that anywhere else, you know?
Some hapless motorist thinks, what's that?
Yes.
Yeah. All right, I think we're going to be going at the top of the hour here at the 15 mark.
The block of flats parked next to
just shows you how far away they are from your time zone. For me specifically,
bit of kit.
5 hours ahead.
Yes, indeed.
Got another couple pair of touring cars. This is exciting.
You've got one of next year's British touring cars. The hybrid Toyota Corolla is there, I notice, as well as other cars that have just been out in that shoot.
Ah, so the British Touring Car Series must also be switching to hybrid power. Let me look into that, because they said next year's.
And those are some great cars as well, by the looks of things.
Yes. Now, whether they're going to be allowed up with this or be held there ready for their batch, because there's practice for that later on, we will wait and see.
Yeah, there's in that BMW there. That's the E92 Eurofighter, which has got James Dean in it, who won the Speed Week Drift Corner.
All right, let's see what we got for the BTC C rules 2022. Ah, so okay, so BTCC reveals hybrid details, ditches success ballast for 2022. So for those of you that don't know, BTCC is the British Touring Car Championship. And one of the things that they used to do was if you won one of the races, they would give you sort of a ballast as a success weight in an attempt for one person to not just win out the weekend, right? With more weight, they'd be slower. But it seems as though they're ditching that for 2022. Cosworth is going to be supplying the electric units that they're going to be using to make these cars hybrids. Ah, so instead of having ballast weight, what they're going to be doing is restricting the amount of power the hybrid gives them. So in its purest form, the hybrid boost will be available for 15 seconds a lap. But if you are limited, because let's say you just won the previous race, then you'll only have less time to use it. Pretty interesting.
But right now, the Festival of Speed highlights batch being prepared, ready to go.
All right, let's...
It's another of the great selling points of Festival of Speed. It doesn't matter how many cars you think you know about or are prepared to see. There's always something, and you do a double take. So I think quite a few that we've already seen are going to go again. Nothing wrong with that. And is it the Curtis Offenhauser that's going to go first? Possibly.
Yeah, Curtis Craft Offenhauser, that's not particularly, it was never really built for hill climbs. Rather ovals like the Indy 500.
Frank Curtis, the man behind that car. And five times 400 brake horsepower, Andrew Offenhauser competed in the race.
All right, let's see what we got coming up first. This thing's pretty cool. Take a listen. Look at the small, thin tires.
This car.
And again, not everyone gives it the beans all the way out, right? Because especially if you're driving something like this, this is a hard car to drive. Look at it, he's wrestling this thing. Sounds awesome, though.
Too much power, always a handful.
Sonny looks busy behind the wheel. Garrett Owens is also into his aero engine monsters as well. So he's driven a wide variety of machinery.
What a beautiful car. Cool.
And effectively, that was a car that was designed to go around ovals. It wasn't designed to...
it's a good point as well.
European circuits, really.
Car that was not designed to take left and right turns.
Playing a little with the throttle, but I would say not too much. It looks like it's on... Yeah, it's on historic Dunlops, by the looks of things, which I know from experience have really no grip at all.
And he got...
Love that. Time doesn't matter. This guy was not giving it the beans. But we'll see what top times can come out of this one, this group. I think the 48 is the fastest time of the day so far. Let's see what we can get.
Released.
Look at this thing.
First of all, including their 119, Pat Blaney-Edwards.
Wrestling it around.
Hustles on. One of the more spectacular of historic races, isn't he?
He is, and he always gives 100%. You know when he's in a race, he's always
going to... And you know how quick that guy was going because he's already done, and they just panned to him, right? They release these cars every, I think it's like 30, 40 seconds or something like that.
The Mark II Jaguar, and it looks like it's firing now on all cylinders.
Oh, the Jag going up again now that it is running properly.
It sounds more urgent. And he's steering the other way to the... way he's going, which is much more Grant Williams.
Absolutely, yes. Normal service has been resumed. Yeah. I think. So, very flamboyant driver is the Welshman Grant Williams. Great character as well, and again, actually part of the Goodwood fabric.
What an awesome thing to see go around.
When there's a St. Mary's touring car race with him not in it, in the lead battle, and sideways.
Yeah, and that's the thing. He's always sideways, but he's
still
quick.
Oh, baby. OG Lotus Formula One car. Karun Chandhok driving this thing. Look how wide the rear tires are.
Particularly excited about driving. He's obviously well versed in historic Formula One cars because he's a Williams heritage driver. So he's driven a huge number of cars from all eras. Probably second only to Martin Brundle in terms of the number of Formula One cars he's driven. And then, following him is the famous six-wheeled Tyrrell.
Oh,
some people loved and some people hated.
Six-wheeled Tyrrell, Formula One car coming up right after this Lotus. Let's see it. Where is she?
Absolutely. And
there
car,
it is.
Lovingly put together by period parts, exactly as it would have been in the period. Just wonderful to see. I mean, that was an era where it wasn't a wind tunnel. It was a pencil and a bit of string.
Awesome.
And the fertile imagination of the designer to come up with the best way of going quickly.
Exactly. And the small front wheels was... The thinking behind it was to have a smaller frontal area. Because obviously, the bigger the front wheels, the more air is going to get trapped by them. So
it was all about aero. That's the reason why they swapped to four small ones instead of two big ones. This is, but yeah, like they just mentioned, this was before the days of wind tunnels and things.
That doesn't matter.
Ford GT40 through, and others.
Classic GT40.
As a flavor of what we can expect over the course of the weekend.
Let me know how the volume is, guys, if anyone's tuning in, if this is too loud or anything like that.
Remembering certain drivers, others remembering different periods of the sport.
Wow, what a beautiful, beautiful machine.
Ford GT40, a Porsche 956, Ryder Becker's car.
One of the best race cars of all time, the Porsche 956.
The Porsche 956, forgive me, not 962, the 956, the first iteration of the car. Third, this was. In 1983 at Le Mans.
What do we got coming up next? Ooh, we got a 911 rally car.
That comes from our Pro Drive acknowledgement. David Richards' company that built these cars that did great things.
Beautiful, beautiful thing. Contrary to popular belief, guys, Porsches were not just street cars. They did race the 911 in rally. They did race the 959 in Dakar. They did race the 911 in Dakar as well back in that area.
Ah, okay.
I only know that because I think he's only here tomorrow, hopefully driving my car.
Oh, I see. Right, you commandeered him first, did you? Right.
Wow.
Tony Sinclair, forgive me. Yes, he's the man behind the wheel. So Grant Reed owns it. Tony Sinclair driving it.
What is this?
And,
what is this?
Mario raced it in his qualifying heat, but Whisper It went off, so he was the favourite to win the main race.
There's the Alpha again.
Had an off and therefore didn't start. Now, this is Tom Andrew again with the Italian touring car Championship 155 twin spark in, as I was saying,
mega sound out of this
car livery, and as I say, it was one from the Italian series.
Such a great era of touring cars, that.
Yeah, agreed.
It was, but then it got a bit out of hand. That was the problem.
Yeah,
the manufacturers had to overspend.
So
I mean, go and ask Tim Harvey and others, they will say what a great era it was, because what drivers were getting paid was just out of this world.
Yeah. Well, on the screens at the moment is that wonderful Lotus 18 that Stirling Moss used to win the Monaco Grand Prix.
This is a Formula One car, guys.
And you can see the panels still removed, as Stirling Moss had.
Yeah.
And I always think, actually, the McLaren Senna, which has a kind of window into the door, is quite reminiscent of this 18.
Yeah, right.
But just what an amazing piece of history.
Wow.
And the Porsche 962 is another just
This is the 962, one of the best race cars of all time.
The factory was savvy enough to be able to supply, prepared to supply, competitive cars to customers that could take on this and beat them.
C8 Corvette.
Really,
is this any special,
cars,
or is this
so
just a C8 with an aero livery on it?
And be competitive.
Yeah, I mean, it started with the 917, really, and then the 956, the 962, and Porsche dominated. You know, I mean, there really hasn't been another.
Matt Black,
like
Aero is one of the leading sponsors for McLaren, so it's interesting to see them in a Chevrolet here.
And as you say, David, that's because they gave them private teams, and if the works team faltered, then private teams picked up the pieces.
Indeed so. You
know, he's giving it the beans.
Or Yerst or Richard Lloyd's team all being able to do great things. Now, I understand that the last car here is going to be the Chevrolet of Sam Schmidt, who had a very nasty race accident many, many years ago, was left quadriplegic, but Sam came back to run his own IndyCar, Champ Car team.
Wow, this guy's quadriplegic.
Arrow, he is going to complete this batch, as I understand it, but
Starting
commitment to come back,
that's pretty incredible.
What the hassle of running a team and all the extra demands that has.
Pretty incredible indeed. This man is a quadriplegic and he is driving a Chevrolet C8 Corvette up the hill at Goodwood. This will finish out the session for us, guys.
It's a sport that obviously he's grown up loving, and you know, to get back into it is a great aim. You know, it's a great way to, you know, to speed the process up. But no, great to see him going up the hill.
Nice.
And again, it's something different. It's a different car, isn't it? I mean, completely reworked to allow for Sam's requirements, very specific. But there are one or two more cars still to go after that.
He's going pretty good.
The Arrow making its way up to the top of the hill.
Hold on. Bring it in here for a second. Okay. The car that we're about to see go up the Goodwood Hill, and yes, I paused the live stream, deal with it. The car that we're about to see is a 6.5 liter naturally aspirated V12 that on its own makes 1,000 horsepower. This is Aston Martin's super hypercar, whatever the frick you want to call it, okay? The Aston Martin Valkyrie. Now, I'm not going to talk for the entire duration of the hill climb, and I hope to God that the announcers don't either, because this Cosworth engine revs to 11,000 RPM, okay? So drink it in, listen, and enjoy, and hope to God that this guy gives this thing the beans and he doesn't just baby it after the start.
The top of the hill. Valkyrie leaving the line. I think that's Darren Turner behind the wheel.
Listen to that.
Certainly, I'm certainly going to say that's not true. But he was Darren's, you know, obviously a works Aston driver and has been a driver for them for many, many years. Class wins at
Lamar,
manufacturer, safe pair of hands, and you know he's driven so many cars, but he was so excited about driving this this weekend. You know, I suppose it's a kid in a candy shop, isn't it?
Look at it go!
2 years ago, he was given something rather tamer, and he was a little bit, I'll do my bit and I'll drive it for Aston, but really wanted something faster.
Well, he's got it now.
Every racing driver does do it that yet.
Shut
faster
the fuck up.
And vastly more expensive.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you say safe pair of hands. Darren's also been involved in, and we'll see it in a little while, being part of the development process of the new hybrid car.
What up, Will? How
are
you doing,
championship,
man? Oh, my God, that thing is crazy.
Toyota Corolla.
And that was one of the first times, by the way, that we've seen the Valkyrie go all the way up.
The new Michelin.
What you guys are looking at right here is a hydrogen-powered Le Mans prototype car.
Racing. I'm not convinced that door was meant to be up. But the car heading to the top of the hill, a driver I've yet to be told about.
I think the I don't think the door is supposed to be up, considering the driver is trying to reach for it. Mm. Well, he's making the best of a bad situation and giving the crowd a wave. So,
womp womp, the door came open.
But that's only been launched this week. I mean, this is, you know, again, very Goodwood, something that's totally hot off the press.
Exactly.
Hydrogen
and a lot
here.
Of these cars have hardly turned a wheel. There's certainly a couple of cars I know on the program that. You know, this is their test, their first test.
Yes.
There's the wonderful.
Yeah, that's also very true.
Bread van going through Malcolm, which will probably be on the screens after this. Bread van, which famously a five-time Le Mans winner, Emanuele Pirro, drives with such splendor. I think it's a good word. Here we are. It's
one of the most priceless cars at Goodwood, the bread van.
Revival. And he's so quick in it. And I think it's owned by the Halusas. And it's got a fresh engine in it.
Ooh, a fresh engine.
Is as quick as it sounds lovely.
Yes, indeed. Just going back to the Michelin, green GT Mission H24, hydrogen powered. It exists in preparation.
Seen some pretty awesome cars during this stream. We got the Valkyrie, we got the Puma, we got
the Le Mans 24 hours in 2024.
The bread vans.
So we're looking well into the
pretty awesome cars, guys.
And Le Mans sports cars. Has been brilliant.
All right, we're going to do two more cars after this, and then we do have to call
it. For a long time. You know, we think of Formula One hybrid.
I wonder if that thing's running okay. It's being a little smoky.
But Le Mans has always been at the cutting edge of pushing new technologies, which is great.
It doesn't seem that long ago that we got all excited about diesel. That now seems like a long, long way time ago.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was decades ago. God.
Yeah, but look what's happened in sports car racing since. Extraordinary, isn't it? That's
oh,
time.
Mama. Jaguar.
Right, in the D-Type.
What a good thing.
That's Sam Hancock again.
No, it's not a Sam helmet. He has a bit of orange on the side.
Yes, right.
Following that D-Type is the E-Type, which I believe is the car.
Okay, the D-Type is the race car, and the E-Type is the road car. Okay, we got it.
It was a 1-2, wasn't it?
I will say yes and not.
They did.
Indeed.
By recollection,
yes,
I think it was Steve McQueen that actually had a D-Type that was road legal.
Yes, on the debut for the E-Type. Were mighty, mighty impressive.
I think that was the fifth car.
Yes.
Amazing, isn't it? And then the George Bevan imp, the sort of car that Bill McGovern.
Sunbeam imp.
The British Saloon Car Championship. 3 years on the bounce, Bill was touring car.
Touring car, not a rally car.
An era when it was all to do with the engine size of the car. It was four classes, and you could keep winning a class, and that's how lots and lots of people won their championships. But the Bevan tuned imp. Michael Creese, who.
Awesome, cool thing.
Possibly coming back to the British Touring Car Championship this year now. He's going to drive the car over the weekend as well, but it's Jonathan Bevan today. That's great to see, isn't it?
Yeah, fabulous thing. Because you could
sounds awesome too.
The British Saloon Car Championship, by never finishing higher than third.
Oh, absolutely. Overall. Yeah. As long as you want your class. Yeah. I mean, Richard Longman did it. We've seen the Nick Swift Mini. It was that type of 1275. I mean, irrespective of what Nick can do with the car in Goodwood races, I mean, there was no way that in period the Minis were ever going to get anywhere near Ford Capris. It just, you know, didn't happen. And even when they had split races, go to Alton Park or Mallory Park, they'd have one race for Class A and Class B, the bigger cars, one for the small cars. But even that was always won by Class C, the 1600s, not the Class D 1300s. So.
Oh boy, we got ourselves a Camaro.
And of course, go back to the.
I wonder what the deal is with this car, where it raced, where it competed.
The Chevrolet Camaro, the Nigel Garrett, Stuart Graham Camaro Z28 in the Brut 33 colour scheme.
Wow.
Which is another car that makes a great noise.
Yeah, I was just thinking, actually, it's lovely to have all these cars with straight pipes on, so you can hear at the Festival of Speed. So many times at a race circuit, they have to put a silencer on to meet the requirements.
What a beautiful Camaro. What the hell? Noise.
You don't hear it often.
Yeah, that's right. And grid's full of these. Rather rule the roost. And then the rule makers decided, right, these American cars are getting a bit out of hand. So they got rid of the big bangers, capped it at 3 litres. So for then a time, we had the British Saloon Car Championship as really only eligible for Ford Capris. And that's why they then had to have another look at it. And for 1980, up the engine size.
Travis Wilkinshaw Racing, that is TWR, the company that often modified Jaguars for racing, had their hand at the British Touring Car Championship with Rover.
Of the time, yes. Yes, yeah. Alan Gower, you're listening. It's all got better since. But he says trying to stay in a job. But yeah, I mean, it was of the time.
Wasn't the most reliable car.
People are always going to be trying to find that edge, aren't they?
Yeah. Well, this car, I mean, one of the reasons it fell out of favour with the scrutineers in the UK was for the wheel arches that were outside the regulations. And Tom Walkinshaw's defence was that that's how the cars were built in Africa. Not many people in Africa ever laid claim to owning a Rover Vitesse. And TWR, Tom Walkinshaw Racing, then became known in the paddock as Third World Racing because of his excuse of
Third World Racing. That's incredible. What a story.
Getting as close as he could to the regulations. And
anyway, so this is the current BTCC car. The next one Toyota will be the hybrid with the new rules.
Car that Rory Butcher and Sam Smelt drive within the British Touring Car Championship. A factory-backed team run by Speedworks Motorsport up in Northwich in Cheshire. And a race
winning
car.
The hybrid one?
This, with I think I'm right in saying James Cole at the wheel of it, is next year's touring car. Hybrid technology comes to the BTCC. And again, it's the Toyota Corolla that carries.
It'll be interesting to see on Sunday if they both go full out, which one can get that top time.
Advisor, but exploring this car that Darren Turner has done some of the development work on, and also Andrew Jordan. Now,
Jesus.
From one extreme to the other. You know, we were talking earlier about the Beast of Turin.
Look at all the heat coming off this.
Big, this is why.
So,
look at the amount of involvement.
I think the start line. It's
both of these guys have balls of steel with no helmet.
Cobra.
You're joking, really?
Yeah. It just has to start putting the brakes on almost immediately after the start line to get through Madrid.
This guy is hauling.
You were saying earlier he drove this down to the south of France. I suppose one of the reasons for that is there's barely a truck big enough to contain it because it is an absolutely mighty thing. But no crash helmet, driver exposed, passenger grinning from ear to ear. If you feel like applauding anybody, Duncan Pittaway is a good person to applaud because he really is one of the great characters of Goodwood in one of the standout cars, no question.
And there's a lot going
Holy
on there.
Shit.
If you watch his right arm, you know, he's,
another
he's
one.
Certainly very busy. There's Jochen Mass.
They're hauling too.
Racer, sports car legend, touring car legend, and another Goodwood regular as well, isn't he?
Absolutely, yeah. And one of the house captains at the members' meeting. And he's always happy to be here, Jochen. He always enjoys himself.
Why wouldn't you be? You know what I mean? Why wouldn't you be happy to be there, you know?
A lot of their historic collection. And I think has driven almost every type of silver arrow.
Look at this
imagine.
Thing! Look how there. Tall it is!
He does, yes.
This looks like Dory from Nemo.
When he gets home
in terms of her body, that fish, you know what I mean?
German legislation at the moment, doesn't matter whether you're a citizen or not, because this is why the Porsche Super Cup,
look at this.
The British Grand Prix, has been axed.
It's got the burble tune from an F80 M3, nice.
For Jochen, the point is, for Jochen to come and do this, fair play.
Yeah. Just had a shot there of Duncan crossing the finisher line and the sort of exhaust flames getting somewhat close to the straw bales down the side.
Dylan, this thing is bonkers, right? That thing is mental, man.
Mental. But yes, Jochen Mass grinning from ear to ear.
This thing's pretty cool, too. Not going to lie. Look at these two. Literally entirely exposed, pretty much. Just sending it.
Goes out of the corner and might know he's not going to catch you.
Oh, here goes the Mini.
For the want of trying. So in the type of car that won the British Saloon Car Championship in 1978-79 series, Nick Swift with his leaden right foot bolted to the floor, blasts off.
He's cruising.
I think what he's realized is that he can now treat this as a practice session.
Yes. So, talking of which, Drift Corner.
Oh boy.
And there are some.
The drifters are here.
In this as well. Drifting has always been one of the recent highlights, hasn't it? And from a perhaps rather hesitant, well, should we invite the drift cars over? It's become a real hit.
It has. It really has. Because it is. It's another world. This is 350Z. And it's just, you'll see as the weekend goes on, they do crazier and crazier things. And they'll come into the corner here at Malcolm. And they'll be facing the wrong way about 40 metres before the corner, before flicking it around and drifting around the corner.
And the precision with which it happens is extraordinary as well, because you've only got that narrow strip of tarmac. Going on the grass doesn't help you at all. So you've got a finite amount of real estate with which to do this.
Yeah, it's this is amazingly skillful drivers. This heads through Malcolm. I've always wondered, they all must have quite good tyre sponsors.
Shredding it in the R32.
It's one of them, Tessa Wittock, the other.
Oh, is he beached on the grass? Nearly, nearly.
Easy. All right, we'll see one more drifter, and then we'll close it out for the day. We'll be back tomorrow, same thing.
Sim racing.
Car news and then some Goodwood stuff, guys. This has been a ton of fun. Love watching this with you guys.
What could be closer to drifting? Not that, that's for sure.
How did he get on?
It wasn't necessarily for him, let's put it like that. Yeah.
Well, he looks great in a drift car.
Absolutely right. Yeah. That's one to my Power Max there. Another of the Driftworks cars.
R33, Skyline.
It's worth saying that these drivers, you know, they build the cars themselves with their own teams. You know, they get their hands dirty in the paddock. You'll see them doing certain tweaks and improvements to them.
Hell of a sound.
With only one hand on the steering wheel.
It is very, very impressive. You've got Dodges, Nissans, BMW, Toyota, and the Ford Mach-E that Paul Swift and Richard Westbrook are sharing. That is due to be in our Drift Corner class as well.
Look at this Beamer.
Now this is always a dramatic car to watch, isn't it? BMW that become used.
I love when people go like top speed all out. Look at this.
Yeah, that's James Dean, and he's been, as you can probably tell, he's been up this hill.
What a beast!
So he's probably got a bit of an advantage on some of the other cars.
James Dean is a savage.
Showing us why he gets invited every time.
Look at this, dude. Look at this guy go.
And there is an extraordinary amount of power in these cars. There he comes, completely sideways, the wrong way into Malcolm, flicks it around on the power.
Jeez Louise.
Complete carbon Kevlar body panels. He's the 2019 Drift Masters European champion, and that's a mere 800 horsepower for you.
Yeah, I mean,
S15, Nissan 240.
And most of them are 700, 800 horsepower, which you need if you're going to need to light up.
Pretty good, not as good as James Dean, but pretty good, pretty good. Ooh.
You need the power, and you can see there's extra steering angle on the front wheels as well. So if you get a chance in the paddock, try and have a look under these wheel arches, because they've all been completely redesigned, so they've got much more lock.
Damn.
Look at that, what a great waste of rubber.
Absolutely, what is it, a set of tires per run?
Probably.
What
at least,
a great waste of rubber.
The smoke is kind of clearing, but there's no point going in a straight line up the hill, is there? Kevin Quinn in the Nissan Silvia. 3-litre engined car, but again, 800 horsepower. Dog box transmission.
Here comes Alex Hildebrand.
Oh, boo to this guy. No, I'm just kidding. It's tough to follow up, James Dean, you know?
And fittingly with Sonoco sponsorship. Since we're celebrating Roger Penske this weekend, it's
all right, friends. We're going to call it as the drifters finish up here. This is Money Shift in the Morning. We're talking about some Goodwood stuff today. I think we'll kick it back tomorrow. Maybe we just do a Goodwood style stream where we just watch the cars and just hang out for about a couple hours. Yeah, maybe we can do a 2-hour stream tomorrow. We'll start at 8. We'll watch Goodwood till 10. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in this morning. I will see you guys soon. Shout out to Dylan with the like. Appreciate that, my man.